Hi, it's Gordon here. It's been a long time since I put a video on YouTube, and that's because I had an addition to my family in December, young Sebastian, and now he's 6 months old. So things have settled down enough for me to start putting some more videos on YouTube. So what am I talking about today? I'm talking about death and the fear of death. This is a two-part video series. The second part is me doing a hypnotic induction to help those people who have fear of death. Now, this goes out to ex-Jehovah's Witnesses, but it goes out to anybody because ex-Jehovah's Witnesses aren't the only ones who have the monopoly on fear of death. Lots of people are frightened of dying, and it's understandable, right? Absolutely. So what is it about this fear of death that we have? We worry about it a lot. Many people worry about it incessantly. In fact, given that we live so many years, 70 years or whatever, 80 years, some people spend the whole of their life, when they get to the age when they realize that there's a possibility they're going to die, not a possibility, probability, then they begin to worry about it. I can recall when my daughter first discovered the possibility of dying, and I can remember it came up in a conversation, and she cried, and she said, I said, why are you crying? She said, because I don't want to die. And I can recall in her class, I teach Spanish, and we were talking about hypnosis as it happens, and regression and past life regression. And one of my students, who was only about 7 or 8, started to cry. And he said, I'm crying because I don't want to die. Okay? Now, this is a primordial fear. It's one of the main fears that we have. So let's just amplify it a bit. Let's look at this fear of death and see what it's all about. You see, what happens is this. When we become frightened of something, strange things happen in our body. Okay? Now, fear of death is a normal thing. It's good to fear death. If we didn't fear death in the slightest, what would happen? Well, we would behave in very reckless ways. We would put our life in danger. But life's too precious. We don't want to die. We're frightened of dying. And so we behave properly. We look when we cross the road. We don't drive at 3,000 miles an hour. We wear a seatbelt, etc., etc. However, even though we live our life carefully many times, that doesn't stop us from worrying. And when we're frightened, as I was saying, we have strong chemical reactions in the body. Things happen. When we're frightened, we go into what's called fight or flight. Now, everybody talks about fight or flight. We all know about it. But one of the key things that probably people don't talk about in this fight or flight mode when we're frightened is that the body shuts down a lot of its organs, or a lot of the use of the non-critical organs. It redirects the blood. It moves the blood away from the brain and into the muscles. So you can imagine, can't you? If you were frightened, if you have excessive levels of fear, then you are not functioning at your optimum. Your body's not supplying your body the way it should. Okay? Now, if that goes on for a long time, then it can cause health problems. It can cause mental problems. Because you're having vast amounts of adrenaline pumped into your system. When we're frightened, we get an adrenaline rush. Now, that feels great. And it's absolutely necessary when we need to run like hell or fight like hell, fight to the death. But when we get adrenaline into our bodies and we don't use it, and it's just there, it causes massive strain on the body, massive. And it can make us ill. So here we're in the situation where we're frightened of death. I've had my moments, eh? And being a Jehovah's Witness, wow. When you're a Jehovah's Witness, every time something happens, you feel great. When something happens in the world, that means, whoa, look at this, a war, an earthquake, the end's coming, sign of the times. But when you leave and something happens, boom, sign of the times. And you become fearful. Now, first things first, I don't think that people who say they're frightened of dying, I don't think they've got it quite right. Because death itself is not much to be frightened of. There's not a lot happens. Death, and I've had the misfortune, the fortune, to be present when somebody died. And I'll tell you this, it happened like that. They died and that was it. They were gone. It only took a second, and it certainly didn't look painful. If anything, it looked very, very, very relaxing. Okay, because the bit that we're frightened of is not the actual death, it's the bit beforehand. It's the cause of the death. What might it be? A fatal accident, or, you know, something dreadful, trapped underground, drowned, anything like that. So it's really, it's the fear of how we're going to die. But let's put this in perspective. The deaths that you see on television are not real deaths. Okay, these are actors who were paid to make it look good. So what happens? People seem to take ages to die in all the films. People have been stabbed 700 times. They fall to the floor, blood squirting out everywhere, and yet they still manage to say the most important lines of the whole film in those last few seconds. And sometimes more. I watched The Matrix. And when the girlfriend of Neo died, it took her ages. She had about 7 spikes sticking out of her body, and she went on yapping and yapping and yapping. Now, in real life, that doesn't happen. Because your body has this tremendous mechanism. And this mechanism is based around, hang on a minute, when things get too bad, when things get beyond our ability to handle them, the body releases into the system a massive amount of drugs. Our bodies are the most incredibly strong chemist that we have. Our bodies can give us drugs. It can give us a painkiller that's 100 times stronger than the strongest morphine. So when we're at the point of dying, our bodies are sorting out for us that we go easily. Okay? Now, yes, some people do have chronic pain when they're dying. However, there are lots and lots of drugs. So mainly when people die and they've had pain or they die of cancer and things like that, long drawn out illnesses, at the end, they don't even know anything. And they don't know pain because they're normally drugged up to the eyeballs. So really, it would be very unusual for you to have an extremely long and drawn out and painful death. It would be unusual. Okay? Certainly with modern science. It doesn't happen now. Modern medicine. So this fear that we have of death, well, do you think there's a little bit of it as well that's based on the fact that we don't know what's going to happen afterwards? We don't know. And that's the bottom line. And no matter who tells you, no matter how many people tell you, it's certain, the Bible says, the Quran says, the Bhagavad Gita says, Buddha says, no matter how many people tell you, nobody has conclusive proof. And this is the bummer. And this is what causes us an issue, because we don't know. And it's that fear of the unknown that causes us problems. Because we don't know, what if there's nothing? What if there's something? What if? And we don't know. So, I know some of you watching this will be what I would call atheists without any belief. Okay? And some of you will have some belief, and some of you won't know. And that's fantastic. All of those beliefs are great if they work for you. But let me tell you a little bit about what I think is a great way of preparing yourself for the big day. And let's face it, we're all going there. Nobody since the beginning of time has managed to escape death. It's happened from the beginning of time to now. You might live a bit longer, you might manage to scrape to 120. I've heard of people living to 130, 140. But it has an end. It has an end, and it always has had an end. So why we go on thinking that we don't want to die, when death is an intrinsic part of life? It is the most fundamental part of life, death. So I've got this friend who one day made a decision about his belief. You see, at the end of the day, it doesn't matter what we believe, as long as what we do believe works for us. You see, that sounds like, well, that just goes without saying, of course it should work for you. But let me tell you, there are a lot of people who hold beliefs that work against them. There are people who have beliefs that are so rubbish that it makes them sad for their whole life. There are people that have beliefs that have been given to them by a parent or by somebody who they respected. And the beliefs don't even work. And they stick with them. And the sad thing is that the person who gave them the belief doesn't even live up to it anyway. And probably doesn't believe it anyway. So, are your beliefs working for you? Well, this is what my friend said. He said to me, you know what, Gordon? I don't know if there's anything after death. I don't know. And nobody can prove it to me. Maybe there's nothing. Or maybe there's something. And I don't know, and I won't know until I get there. So he said, this is what I do. I believe that there is something. I believe that this isn't the only thing and that life does go on. And he said, I believe that because of two reasons. If I get to the end of my life and I die and there's nothing, well, I've lost nothing. But having a belief like that has helped me to get through life and has helped me to be happy. And then if I get to the end of my life believing that there's more, and I die and there is more, fantastic, even better. It's a win-win. Okay? And I thought, well, isn't that nice? Simplicity itself. Nobody knows. So just believe what you want. Believe what makes you happy. And then wait and see. Of course, there'll always be a doubt in your mind. There's a doubt in everybody's mind. Even the people who say, I do not doubt. There's a doubt in the mind. Of course there is, because there isn't any solid proof. So, basically, that's what I do. I believe until somebody can prove otherwise. And what will happen is, on the day, the final day, when I shuffle off this coil, I'll know, just as you will. Okay? Now, some people say, oh, hang on, you can't play around with God like that. No. Playing around with your beliefs. No, no, no. But come on. How many people do you know that have said, no, I don't believe, I don't believe, I don't believe there's a God, I don't believe there's anything. We're here by mistake, by accident. And then they get to the very end of their lives and suddenly they're praying to God like the most fervent Catholic. Please, God, if there's a God, forgive me for what I've done. Many atheists, and I saw one who was talking about his fervent belief that there was no God, no God. And as he talked, behind him, something fell off his shelf. And you know what his first words were? My God, what was that? Okay? Because when the chips are down, who do we turn to? We always do. So what would you, if you were God, what would you prefer? Would you prefer somebody to believe in you all of their life and then dying go on to something else? Or would you prefer someone to deny you the whole of the life and then in the last moments of the life suddenly say, oh, please, God, I'm sorry if you're there, I'm sorry. What would you rather? I know what I would rather. Somebody who maybe believed in me the whole life. You've got nothing to lose. The only thing that'll stand in your way of that belief is your ego. It's just your ego. But you only need to do that if you want to. Because I'm going to finish now. I'm going to ask you a question. Now, I don't want you to answer this question with the logical mind, okay? Now, what happens is, I want you to trust your first answer. Because the first answer is the answer that comes from the emotional brain. It comes from your unconscious mind. And it's the true answer. It's really what you think. The second answer, the third one, is by the time you've considered it and logically thought, no, well, you rationalise it, no, well, it can't be that. I'll dismiss that first answer that came up, that was actually the truth, and I'll say it's this, okay? So, prepare yourself, take a nice deep breath, and I want you to listen for the first answer. It might be a word, it might be a feeling. Your belief about life after death. Whatever it is it making you happy now? First answer. Okay. So, what was your answer? If your answer was yes, little flowchart, keep doing the same thing. Fantastic. If your belief, whether it's in there's nothing or there's something, if it's making you happy, fantastic. However, if your answer's no, then flowchart. Do something else. Do anything else. Change your belief. Because what's the point of believing in something that's making you unhappy when you don't even know if it's true? Eh? What's the point? And what's the point of being frightened of death when you know it's going to happen? It's like the only certainty in your life is your death. The only certainty in my life is my death. And there's the phone. So I'll see you later in the next one.